share something with you.
Something with you.
Oh God.
Oh God.
Wanna share something with you. Music is the rod and we are Moses. Leading God's children to the promised land. Music is the voice of his brother Aaron.
Lisa's always
music
for the good times.
Music
for the bad times.
Music
when you're in love.
Music
when it's over.
Music
when I'm on fire.
Music
every good night.
Music
every last time.
Music
Lisa's always
music
saving my world.
Music
saving my soul.
Music
saving my girl.
Music
Lisa's always
music
saving my world.
Music
saving my soul.
Music
saving my girl.
Music
just like music. To relax my mind so I can be free and absorb the sound that keep me round, doing my thing constantly with no worries, peace to keep merry.
Tuned into Meeting of the Minds of South Florida on K1NG Radio with Paula and Chris.
Every time they come around, something is about to go down. Meeting of the Minds in FLA, yeah. Listen to what they say.
Meeting of the Minds is sponsored by ConceitedClothing.com and Lavish Bay by Tamara on Etsy.com.
One good thing about music, when it hits you,
you feel no pain.
Whoa, whoa, I say one good thing about music, when it hits you,
you feel no pain.
Hit me with music.
Good evening, everyone. Sorry for the delay and the technical difficulties. This is Paula from Meeting of the Minds of South Florida. Everyone knows this is Chris. Everybody hates Chris, right?
Everybody hates Chris, and I hate everybody, and that's okay. We're going to make it work.
Bonsoir, hola, hello, bonjour, konnichiwa. Oh, speaking of konnichiwa, there. Thanks to all the Instagram followers. Thanks for everybody that shows us love. But there is a gentleman by the name of Foreign Cut, who changed his name to Japanese Cut. He's a producer out of Tokyo. Japanese Cut, thank you so much for sharing our material. Thank you for giving us encouraging words and inspiration. And also, Facebook, thank you for everybody that supports us. I wanna send a special shout out to Tyrell Roberts from the Flywheel Roberts Show, him and Baby Doll out of Connecticut. Thank you for sharing your music. Thank you for the positive words and thoughts. Do you know we started this August the 13th? Do you know tonight is the 13th show?
I did not know that.
Yeah, you didn't know that. And that's a big deal to me because I almost backed out. Every show, I have these meltdowns and panic attacks.
Every
single
week.
I'm just telling you, it's a big deal to me.
Wednesday night, y'all watch out.
I shut down on Wednesday. I shut down on Wednesday night. I don't talk to nobody. I'm going to be on Wednesday, and Thursday morning is worse. Well, tonight we're going to talk about music therapy, how music can be therapeutic. We have three wonderful gentlemen here with us. I have Matt Genius from Sober Words and Beachstone Counseling. I have O'Neill Burton from Cold Red Reggae Band. He's a lead singer. I have Zimroy Lewis from Cold Red Reggae Band, the bass player and the leader. So I'm going to give you a little background about each one of these gentlemen. Matt, I met like a month ago. I was introduced to him by a therapist, and I knew Matt's love for music through the phone. I wasn't video chatting with Matt, but when I mentioned music, the phone lit up. So I knew Matt was my guy to talk about this. For those of you that don't know, Matt is a LMFT, a licensed, what is it? Marriage and family therapist.
That's the lower right there. That's that family therapy. That's
you should have been around with me and him. But anyway, that's a whole different topic. Okay, so this gentleman right here, O'Neill Burton, he has many names, the walk-in jukebox, Rugs, Tony, as I call him. This is my ex-husband, my best friend, my whatever you want to call him, but he's my ride or die. This is Zimroy Lewis, the Zimmy from Zimmer Entertainment, the musical genius from The Garden. This is my brother from another mother. How long we been knowing each other, Zimroy?
What?
2000. Zari was born in 2000. So 20 years. So this is my brother from another mother. And when I tell you this guy is the greatest guy, just don't let him tell you, yeah, man. That's it. It's a wrap. It's a wrap. That's our little secret, what that means. It's a wrap. So, you know, I always, before I start any show, I always give you a definition like it's class 101. Music therapy is an established health profession in which music is used within a therapeutic relationship to address physical, emotional, cognitive, and social needs of individuals. So I just want to share with you how important music is. Music is very important, especially when a baby is in the mother's womb, to listen to conscious music. Very positive music, and I'm going to tell you why. Music is important for children starting in the mother's womb. Music helps them to improve their brain power. It helps them develop social skills. It helps them build their confidence. It inspires creativity. It teaches them patience. It's a great form of expression, and it also teaches them discipline. I always give my positive word at the end, but I'm going to give it in the beginning. Bono said, music can change the world because it can change people. So now that I've introduced everybody to you, and everybody in this room have a love for music. I know in my house we listen to Haitian music, Latin music, reggae, calypso, soca, Japanese music, Portuguese. My 20-year-old takes us all around the world, from City Girls to Frank Sinatra. So I have no other choice but to be in love with music. And music is like a happy space for me. So I know when I'm nervous, I listen to calming music. And when I'm like sad, I don't listen to sad music. I listen to upbeat music to get me out of that bad space. So welcome, gentlemen. Welcome, welcome. Thank you all for being here. So Matt has his own business that I pulled him out of. Zimroy has his own thing going on that I pulled him out of. He's just a loafer. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, but thank you. Thank you for being here, gentlemen.
The therapist is here.
Imagine family therapy 101. Just start on over, man.
So I'm going to tell you, this show is not going to be serious like others. You're going to hear pure jokes. So anyway, we're going to start with Matt. Matt, briefly tell us about your organization.
Well, let me start with thanking you guys for having me here. This is such an important topic. Anytime you're talking about health, mental health, improvement of any lifestyle, it's a conversation that I want to be a part of. So thank you for having me here, guys. My organization is called Beachstone Counseling. That's my private practice. I've been in private practice for about 4.5 years now. There I serve the Tri-County area, Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach. I specialize in black male issues. Mm-hmm. You know, black men don't like to talk about their issues.
Absolutely.
And so when I opened my doors, I wanted to make sure that the community of South Florida knew they had an advocate in me when it comes to mental health and black males. Of course, I'm a marriage and family therapist, so I do a lot of couples work as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I work with a variety of areas, anxiety, depression, you know, conflict resolution, you know, grief and loss. So you name it, the spectrum, I cover it. I also have another company called Sober Words. Sober Words fight stigma associated with substance abuse and mental health. I've been doing that for about 2.5 years now. I do have apparels that I sell, which creates conversation about substance abuse and mental health, which fights stigma. The more conversation we have about substance abuse and mental health, the less stigma there is to have. One of my proudest things that I'm a part of is a page that I started called Hip Hop and Therapy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a conversation starter right there. I'm an advocate of hip hop. It's been my therapy for a very, very long time. And I say that because there are a lot of therapeutic messages
mm-hmm.
in the music. Forget the rhythm. That's something else. That's something, you know, that's
a bonus. That's in the
heart. Yeah, that's already there. But when you actually listen to a lot of the lyrics that have been written over decades, you know, they're very therapeutic. And so on that page on IG and on Facebook, what I do is I create conversations around lyrics that I found very therapeutic, where, you know, artists from back in the days to present day have been calling out some of their issues and talking about mental health for a very long time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I make it my business as a therapist to dissect those lyrics so that people can understand that these conversations are being had. The question is, are we listening? You know,
do you think when they write music, do you think they're speaking from experience in most cases?
Most definitely. You know, like I'm fairly, you know, from the old school, but I still, you know, listen to some of the more present day artists. And once you listen to artists, you ever heard the expression real recognize real?
Mm-hmm.
Once you listen to artists, you know where they're coming from.
Mm-hmm.
You can feel the genuineness in their words and the sincerity in their tones and their inflections. You can hear the pain sometimes in their voices.
Mm-hmm.
I remember listening to Ghetto Boys when I was growing up in Opa-locka, and you hear a song like My Mind's Playing Tricks on Me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that song right there is profound because people don't listen to the music, they don't listen to the words, they just hear the beat.
Yeah. And they start dancing.
They were talking about PTSD, post-traumatic stress. They were
mm-hmm.
talking about things that haunted them in their sleeps, visions that they were seeing. They're talking about psychotic episodes, but
mm-hmm.
people are like, yeah, at night I can't sleep, and just quoting the lyrics and not knowing what it's actually saying.
You mm-hmm. remember the video?
Oh, no. I do remember the
video.
The video was
went into extreme detail.
Right.
Most people didn't take the time
they
to
didn't take it. You know, they just thought it was just pure entertainment,
mm-hmm.
you know, but these guys were talking about things that they've experienced, you know, being in the streets and what being in the streets
yep.
will do to you. You end up with a complex of PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress, which means that you've been traumatized so much that in your present, you're still being triggered by issues and events that happened years ago. So
we did a show that we talked about PTSD a little bit,
right.
and we explained that it's not only with veterans.
Mm.
It's in everyday life. You
yeah.
know, you see something, you experience something. You can see somebody get shot in front of you, and that can send you into PTSD mode, you know? So it's different things that can affect you in life that cause you to suffer from that.
Right.
So let me ask you, I know you're not a music therapist,
right.
but why would you recommend music therapy to someone?
That's a great question. I would recommend music therapy because music doesn't need permission. You know, music doesn't need any permission from anyone. Music doesn't need your consent. It penetrates without asking. You know,
mm-hmm.
and the reason why music therapy is important is because it's the language that all of us speak.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the language that all of us speak, and so once you present music into a situation, it's that element that can change the temperature in the room. You know,
mm-hmm.
based on what we've grown to recognize as something that's normal. In utero, you were talking about that. You know, when a child is in the mother's womb,
mm-hmm.
it's a symphony in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a symphony. It's not just the heartbeat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're talking about, you know, organs that are swishing and gushing and things that are moving.
Mm-hmm.
You're talking about a symphony from the utero.
Mm-hmm.
Forget playing external music. The child is already surrounded by music.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, one of the things that I've learned as a father, I'm a father of four girls, by the way,
Ooh.
Three of which are triplets.
Ooh.
We'll talk about that. One of the things I learned about when you're caring for a child is making sure you can keep that rhythm that they had inside the womb.
Mm-hmm.
So even when you're patting the child, You know, you want to pat the child in the rhythm of the heartbeat. Even when you're burping the child, you just pat a little harder, but it's the same rhythm because that's the rhythm that they're used to inside because it's a regulatory factor in our lives. So that's why music is important. That's why sports, which is also rhythmic, is important. That's why dance is important. You know, all these things that keep rhythm regulates us, meaning it could take us, it could take us from a low point to a higher point or from a higher point to a lower point. It doesn't need permission. So I would recommend music therapy because I know it doesn't need permission and it penetrates faster than what my words can say, you know, what my words can do. And what sometimes your brain will allow you to process. Music just goes in and it creates the change.
When a person does music therapy, would you recommend regular therapy as well in conjunction with music therapy?
Well, it depends on what they're going to music therapy for.
Okay.
Music therapy is a great component for change for a variety of different areas like you read. But let's say if a person is dealing with anxiety, I would definitely suggest that they, if they have the capacity to, that they do see a music therapist alongside a regular therapist as well. Music therapy is like, it's like not necessarily the bonus. People can just go the entire music therapy route. But there are certain things that you may need to process that music therapy won't allow you to process as much as what a psychotherapist such as myself.
Okay.
You know, so it's not to say one is greater than the other or better than the other. It's that you can do certain things with a psychotherapist, which is a conversational therapist, versus a music therapist. And so I would say, you know, you have to pick it, and but both have their value.
Okay.
Let me ask you this.
Sure.
The youth we have going today,
right,
compared to the music we grew up to, how much do you feel like that plays an influence on their decision-making skills and what they do on a day-to-day basis?
Ooh, that's a heavy one.
Kodak, Jack Boy, NBA Young Boy.
Yeah, that's a heavy one because I think that what we hear in the artists today are a direct reflection of what they were, what their parents were exposed to, you know. So it's not necessarily saying that they are better off or worse off, you know. I think when we look and hear their music, we're looking and seeing a new generation,
okay,
right? And so they have people in their generation that are very conscious, that are very, you know, transparent about their issues. You mentioned Kodak Black, who is from South Florida. You know, he's from Pompano. Jack Boy is from Pompano as well. I'm a fan of Kodak. I listen to his lyrics. He speaks from a place of pain as well. You know, XXX, who's from South Florida, you know, God rest the dead, you know.
Juice WRLD
as well. But they talk about a lot of things that they're going through. I think that when we hear them, we're not listening to them and hearing what they actually experience. A lot of these kids are crying out for help. Okay. But the question is, are we actually listening to them and providing them with the right people in their lives to help them, you know, manage what they're dealing with?
Okay.
And so I wouldn't say it's better or worse. I would just say we just need to pay attention. We need to actually listen to what the kids are listening to, right? What our, you know, this generation of kids listening to. And we also need to listen to what the kids are actually saying themselves. Not the artists, but the kids. Because the music is only a symptom of what the greater issues are, you know? And so if they're listening to lyrics that are very depressed, talking about suicide, talking about self-harm, talking about self-medication.
It has a relation.
Exactly, you know? For me, I used to listen to Common. Common was escapism for me, you know? Common used to tell great stories. I used to listen to Biggie, Tupac, Mobb Deep. All of these guys were storytellers that took me outside of my reality, you know? And so that was therapeutic for me. For some of these kids, they're escaping through the lyrics of people that they can relate to as well. So I wouldn't say it's worse or better.
Okay.
So I'm going to ask a question, and we'll start from you, Matt. It's okay. For all of you. How did you get into music?
Man, I don't think I had a choice, man. My family, I come from a family of musicians, you know, and so very early on, I remember seeing my dad play the harmonica. I remember seeing my mom sing all the time. I remember, you know, just being around music. I grew up in the church as well, you know, church is heavily influenced by music. And when I came to the U.S., I was born in the Bahamas. In the Bahamas, of course, you know, we have reggae,
so we're from the same, well, I'm from here, but my family is from the Bahamas.
Nassau, Bahamas, where I was born. So music was always a part of the culture. It was a part of what made us feel alive, what made us come alive. When we gathered together, music was always
that was the coping
exactly,
music.
Whether we're singing, just beating drums, and then when I came here, I was introduced to a wide variety of different genres. I was introduced to hip hop, I was introduced to gangster rap, I was introduced to R&B, jazz, classical, all types of music. And so once I had the opportunity to be a part of it and start creating music, it was a no-brainer. So in middle school, I played in a band, and then in high school, I played in a marching band and symphonic band, and I went off to KMU where I played in their marching band mm-hmm. and symphonic band for a little bit, and then that's when I started to produce my own music, mm-hmm. you know? And so it was always inside of me, still a part of me. And my kids, if you see them, they're musicians as well. We have almost every instrument at the house for them. Two keyboards, four guitars, drum set, you know, recorders, whatever.
Y'all gonna be on the road real soon, huh?
I told you we got a four pack already. We got triplets plus the big sisters, so we're gonna, you know, consult them and see if we can get a band together. You know? So yeah, that's how I got into music, and it's still a part of us, you know. Mm-hmm. It's a way of escape. It's a therapy. It's in my DNA, you know. Mm-hmm. We are the original people, and in the original people is music.
That's how they coped in slavery. They made music in the field.
You gotta go way back before slavery. You know, music mm-hmm. was always therapeutic. It started with the drums as a form of stress relief, communication, mm-hmm. right? And so that's easy, you know, it's already in us. So mm-hmm. it's like when I hear it, for example, I'm a huge fan of Afropop. Mm-hmm. Half the things they say, I don't know what they're saying, but I still enjoy the music. I enjoy the music. It's like it speaks to me. And then, you know, one of the things I do is I go check the charts. The music that I love here mm-hmm. in the States are the ones that's topping the charts in Nigeria, in Ghana. Mm-hmm. So it tells me that what I like and what I love and what I appreciate is being appreciated over there.
We listen to all of that in our house.
That's what I'm saying. So it's in all of us. That's how, you know, I was introduced to music, how I fell in love with music, and how music is still a part of my life today.
Okay. So, Mr. Tony, how did you get into music?
I love this from birth. Mm-hmm. Love it like a food from before I know myself. I love music. Growing up in the country, used to beat pans, and my mother used to run here. It's boy, stop your eyes. Nice around the house. And I keep going, music, singing here, singing there. And then came to America, mm-hmm. was in a band called, the name of the band, I forget, I don't remember quite the name of the band, Danji.
Oh, okay.
And Carl and all that.
Mm-hmm.
No, I was a Garvey Uprising.
I forgot the name because you had a plaque with it on there. Yeah.
Garvey Uprising.
441, I remember.
Huh?
441.
441. Yeah. And then the great one came along.
Zimride.
Yeah, and it was a wrap. And how long you guys been in the band together?
Like 18 years.
Wow.
Yeah,
18 years. That's a long time. Because you know it's hard to be in the band for so long.
And then that's where we start to kick off. And you know, I love it. Although I go to hell sometime with you.
Oh, so that's how we going to do this? You going to put my hands in
the gloves are off. The gloves are off. The gloves are off. Hey, we got the therapist right here. And the therapist is right here.
Wait, fight.
You're still one of my greatest supporters. You know what I mean? You encourage me and, you know what I mean? And things like that. So that's where I started. And
it's all right. You got that one. It's okay.
No,
I was wrong, bro.
No, for real. But it's me. You know what?
Ding, ding, ding.
I just support me still. I'll do it. She put me to it and said, don't do that. Do it like this and do it. And I said, all right, baby, I'm going to listen.
But then it pay off, though.
Yeah, it pay off.
Oh, so okay. That's all I needed to know.
I'm telling the man out there, listen to your women sometime when they're talking. Listen, man.
Sometimes.
Yeah. Most of the time.
85%. Sometimes.
Wait. The times he don't want to listen, that just means he just want to be disobedient. That's all.
And that's where you're starting, and I love it. Love is like food to me, man.
Let me tell you, I'm going to tell y'all this story. I remember this guy sat down and asked him, what do he love? He said, music. No, he said, my daughter, music. My daughter, music, by 50 times. I'm not going to tell y'all I was 51st. And he looked at me, oh, and my wife. So I just want to tell y'all that story.
And music is a great thing because I remember one time I was on stage and I was singing a Luciana song.
I remember that clearly.
Lord, give me strength to face another day. And when I got off stage, this guy walked up to me and said, man, he saved my life.
Wow.
He said, I was about to commit murder, double murder. I was going to kill my woman and I was going to kill myself. But when you sing that song, Lord, give me strength, I start to cry. And I have to come up to you and tell you thank you very much.
Sing a little bit of it so people can understand
and
what it is.
The song goes like this. Lord, give me strength to face another day. Journey along life road. Carry my heavy load. Give me strength, oh Jah, to carry on. Oh, my Lord.
Yeah.
So I guess now you understand why the music touched the gentleman that night so much.
Yeah.
So we're going to go to Mr. Zimmy Zimmy that was supposed to be a doctor. Yeah, I'm putting your business out there. So how did you get into music? That's right, because this is my family. That's my brother. That's right. I have a right to do that. This is my safe space. Now, I wouldn't say. So, Zimmy, how you got into music?
Piggyback off about it, I said, you know, music chose me. It's more the music that chose me than me choosing music. I was qualified to do other things. I was in other areas of business before I came into music. And I came into music relatively late in comparison to most people who come to
music. I remember.
So, yes, I came in my early 30s.
Yeah, I remember.
So, but, you know, I had just come back from Jamaica and was contemplating what my next move was going to be. And I walked into an establishment that we all know as
Jamaica. Mm-hmm.
And I saw this fellow here on stage with a number of other guys that I know close to me. And that's when the bug really hit me. I want to do this full time. You know, I could play before. Mm-hmm. When I was a professional, but I couldn't play the guitar and a little bass before. But when I saw him on stage and the other guys, so not just the energy, the camaraderie,
mm-hmm.
That is what I want to do. And I put all my energy into it, and the rest is history.
So I want to tell people a little bit about music. You see people, artists on the stage, and you really, really think it's really easy. You don't know what these three gentlemen go through behind the scene of making music and sharing music with you. Not only the fight from people that should all be in union with them, but it's just the amount of time to perfect the music, to get the lyrics right, the pronunciation. Zimroy is very, very, very big on pronunciation. I don't care if you're going to cover someone's song, you're going to pronunciate the word accordingly. So he's very, you know, particular with that. He's not one of those, and he's also a producer. Yeah, I'm putting that out there too. He's not one of those producers that, you know, rush everything. I remember I had gave them a little idea for a song to do a duet. And I'm not gonna lie, I thought those guys was dead. I kept calling Zimmy, Tony, nobody would answer. I just said, let me go to the studio. I went to the studio. The song had touched them so much, both of them was literally like sick to the stomach, laying on the couch. And I just couldn't believe, but you know, music takes a lot out of you. So when someone shares their music with you, appreciate it because it's hard work. It's just not somebody getting into the mic. You're putting feelings in it. You're pulling from the pit of your stomach to satisfy people. And what makes it easier in the studio because you can rewind, come again, and fix it. But when you're live, it is what it is. Because I done seen some mistakes on stage that a lot of people don't know about, but I watch their faces and I hear and I know. And Matt, I'm sure you can attest to that as well. Because, you know, Matt is a musician as well. His whole family, you know, his kids are into it, and it's hard. So just appreciate music a little more. And I'm going to tell you, I am one of the ones never bought a bootleg CD. Never.
Wow.
Never.
That's true. I respect that.
That's true.
Because being around music and you guys, I would never buy a bootleg CD. Never.
I totally respect that.
Yeah, true.
Even sharing music, I don't share music. I don't share music at all.
She always at the record store.
And you know, with even on, I have an iPhone. Right. I purchase my music.
Wow.
I purchase my music because I respect music just that much.
Right. Yes, it's a whole lot of investment. Music itself is a whole lot of investment, like I said, from the soul, from the heart and soul. And that's why sometimes I will, as a band leader, I get into it sometimes with a promoter or a club owner, whoever we're working for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they hire us to do a major show, right? You know, 15, 20,000 people come into the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, okay, this is what we're charging. And 9 times out of 10, no, that's too much. And I said, I always use this line, don't pay me for the show, pay me for the rehearsal. Because that the work goes into
to the rehearsal.
The song, how many times do you play the song on the show?
Once. But in rehearsal,
20-30 times.
I think I survived how many rehearsals with you guys? Like 2 out of 20 years, maybe 2 or 3 rehearsals, and it was a wrap.
She said she's not coming back.
Wow. Yeah, it was.
That's
oh what no.
Oh, you're at the studio too long. No, yeah, okay. So I come with me.
You know what's funny? The night when you asked if we could change the song, we were rehearsing.
Right.
We were going over the same song. Yeah. She was like, oh, can you guys play the same song?
Listen, yeah. It was too much. I think I survived 2 or 3 rehearsals in 20 years.
Right.
Not me. You okay? Yeah, okay. All right. See you later. That was it. So people really don't understand what music is and what it takes, what it entails. They just think, oh, jump up on stage. Even to get on stage.
Right.
You rehearse for that.
And what people don't understand is that these are human beings as well. Right? They have to go through their daily lives. They have relationships. They have kids. They have responsibilities. Mm-hmm. And so, but when you get and you have to perform, you're bringing all that stuff with you.
To the
stage. And mm-hmm. so sometimes when you hear a record, you're just hearing the record. You don't know what was behind all of what you said, the rehearsals, the preparation.
Yep.
You know, and it's only seldom when you truly, truly listen, you can hear, you know, snapshots of what people really experience, you know?
Mm-hmm. And you know, it's funny, before he used to sing,
right.
I'm being honest.
Right.
I used to kind of antagonize him sometimes.
Wow.
But when I started here,
right.
And he would bring something up to me, and I'm like, really? The night of my show, you really gonna, like, really?
25 years, right. I understand, man.
Right.
Like, really? You really want to talk to me right now? Because you have to get your mind conditioned. You have to focus. Like, all the way here, I listen to jazz. Just jazz, smooth, mellow out, and everything.
I used to say to him.
And I even apologized to him. I said, you know what? I am so sorry because now I know.
I used to get up in the morning and say, all right, baby, anything we have to talk about, let's do it now.
Later. As soon as he get dressed, all the time. Yeah, but you know, it's kind of, it's different now, but I did apologize to him. I said, now I really understand.
Yeah, we seldom understand the artist, man. The artist is a complex individual because they pour out so much. You know, you're just thinking it's the singer, it's the drummer.
Everybody.
It's everybody because they bring all of that energy. Yeah, they bring all
just
that
think
energy
if I was a singer, I'd probably be crying all the time. I can't do it. But you know, it's I'm learning.
And you know what I learned too is that even though they are upfront, not all of them are extroverts. You know, not all of them. Not all of them are just people. You know, people, persons. You know, some of them just would rather be, you know, at home. Right.
You got that right. You got that right.
And so to do that, it takes a lot of mental and emotional work to get on stage every single time. You're anxious. You're tired. You know. You know all that stuff. You bring that energy there. And so it's gratitude. Every time I hear something, it's gratitude. Something that satisfied me, it's gratitude because that work that they put in, you know, it's feeding you because it comes from a place that is healing for them. And you hear it heals you too.
And we don't know how much. So just think, you're having a bad day at home and you know that you have to go sing and satisfy and feed the soul of people. Yeah. So people don't understand that most of the musicians have to take that, what they're having, set it on the back burner, and feed...
And
they have to feed the people the music, what they want. So you put your problems aside, and now you got to bring other people out of their problems with your music. That's a hard job. So
then you have to go and take up back your problem after you finish.
And I tell something. The musician who cannot compartmentalize is in trouble.
Wow.
Is in big, big trouble.
And we see it a lot.
Why do you say that? Like, go next and give me an explanation about
okay, what? Because just like Paulo was saying, you come to the gig and you have this burden, whatever it is. Somebody, you know, your child is sick, your lady's not. See, you and her not seeing eye to eye, whatever it is, and you come to the gig with that, you know how to box that, put a ribbon around it, and put it down, box it up, go on the stage,
and like nothing happened,
and satisfy what we call the expectation of your audience,
right. Wow.
Because they don't care about
your
problems.
Yeah.
They paid their money to come to this place, they're having drinks, and guess what, we also perform in an environment where people are... They're intoxicated. So they're not
fully
conscious. Exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. So you have to you do that, and guess what? That same box that you boxed up at the end of the night,
you got to deal with it.
Pick it up. Wow. If you can't do that, and for me, Bob, I can tell you, with Code Red, one of my gifts is that I can pick up.
If when some, one of them going through. Right.
So I can help you live on stage to get out of it.
Wow.
As a band leader, that's very important. That's good. Because you're dealing with human, just like you said earlier, it's human beings. It's not a laptop up there.
Right, right. Mm.
These are five different people with five different situations.
Mm-hmm.
So if you find out one of your brothers lagging because of something, and the next thing, you have to find the key. You have to have what I call a key for all of them.
Wow.
That unlocks their soul. You know what can get him out of it.
Right.
So no, do it.
Yeah.
Even if it makes you a little uncomfortable, or you have to sacrifice something that you know, something that you wouldn't normally do.
Right.
You know, do it just to get him out of that and get the show.
Listening to him say that, he's a therapist. Seriously.
Yeah, because that's what musicians are.
He's navigating not just his own mental and emotional state. He's navigating people in the band, and you're also navigating the audience.
I'm gonna tell you one thing. I remember I was somewhere. I'm not gonna mention the DJ. This DJ literally played for himself. He was the only one dancing. He literally played for himself. And it's a whole nother story behind that, but. What I like about Zimroy, when Zimroy is playing, say they just started,
right.
He can see the reaction of the audience and the way their band, and I'm not saying it because they're part of me,
right.
But their band transitioned from song to song like no other.
Wow.
You would think that it was a DJ spinning music, right. The way they transition. Seamless. They never have pauses. Wow. You know, like the band say, what's the next song? They don't do that. Yeah. They just transition.
Wow.
And I'm going to tell you, they don't rehearsal. And when they do, as when they're not doing, like when they're doing a personal show for themselves, they don't rehearsal. And if they want to learn a new song, it goes in the text feed, everybody loads, get their part, and that's a wrap. That's how it, so it's like, to me, it's almost like perfection. But when they transition, he feeds from the energy from the audience. He switches out in the middle of the song, and then you'll see the audience just pop up like Jack in the Boxes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's what I love about him. I can watch them play for the rest of my life.
Now I gotta come to a show, man.
I could watch them play for the rest of my life because that's the type of energy, you know, they have.
Because it speaks to you, cuts straight through. You know, just to let you guys in, as a therapist,
right? I have a record player in my office.
Mm-hmm.
And of course I listen to music on my phone too, but I have that record player because the record in itself
mm-hmm.
is nostalgic and therapeutic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it takes me somewhere different when I have mm-hmm. to get that, you know, that record out of, you know, the mm-hmm. sleeve, put it on, you know.
Yeah, it's the process of,
pick up that needle, drop it on there, hear the scratch.
And personally, I love that.
That's what I'm saying. So for me,
mm-hmm.
as a therapist that have to listen to people's problems day after day after day, hour after hour, when I have breaks in between, I go to my music.
And a lot of people don't know therapists. You know what? I'm going to say every job is hard. And, you know, mentally you have to pull yourself back up. But being a therapist, just imagine listening to, I'm just going to give you an example, because you have marriage and family.
Right.
So just imagine if you listen to a woman that says she gets beat.
Right.
By her husband.
Right.
And then you start thinking, I would never do that to my wife.
Right.
Or, you know, if someone would do it. And then to have to pull out of that, to go home,
right.
to deal with your family, it's hard. So people really don't realize the mental, what we go through doing different things.
And that's where music comes in. Because on my drive there, I'm listening to music. On my drive home, I'm just listening to silence.
Yeah.
Even in silence, what people don't understand.
You hear some kind of,
silence can be loud, you know?
Yes.
I get to listen to me now. I get to hear my heart.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I get to listen to my thoughts.
Right.
You know, I get to, sometimes I put down the window just to hear the wind, you know? Music is all around us. It's in nature, mm-hmm. you know?
And I know a couple of doctors that plays music. Like, Zimroy's sister is a doctor, mm-hmm. and she sings, but her love for music, this chick know every song in the world. There's no exception to her. Mm-hmm. Like, if I want to know something about music, I'll call her, and she could tell me, oh, yeah, check this one out. Two people sing it or whatever.
Right.
You know, so, you know, and a lot of doctors use music to escape from everyday, you know, practice as well.
Music, it's such a big part of the form, just the foundation of life itself, because music actually is responsible for the mood that a lot of people go home in.
Right.
You know, it can prevent a fight.
Mm-hmm.
There can be a potential fight in your head.
Right.
And then just like what happened that night with mm-hmm. that guy, the right song comes on, and then that fight is gone.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Think about it this way. You're not gonna put on gangster rap if you just met this girl. You just met this girl, you wanna create an impression and taking her out to dinner, you're not gonna put gangster rap on. So why is it you're gonna put Teddy P? You're gonna put on Teddy P
mm-hmm.
and Lionel. Because you know what direction you wanna go.
Right.
So think about the other end of the spectrum. Somebody who's on the edge and know the perfect, I don't wanna use the word perfect, but
the right song.
The right song that takes him over the edge,
right,
comes on,
mm-hmm.
then somebody can lose their life right there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's what music is.
Yeah.
I've seen it in the club business. I've seen people come inside the club, two women come inside the club, and the DJ, he knows that there's beef going on between those two women. And instead of him just
playing a different route, going a different route.
He's going to play the song that says, oh,
we're going. Yeah.
I'm involved with your
mate.
Yeah, really, I didn't want to say that. Really, Baba, I didn't want to say that. The song that says this girl is involved with the other girl's man, that's the one he's gonna play. Just being mischievous. No, your little mischief, your little
could cause a whole.
Exactly. Mm.
Yeah.
So, you know.
So we're running out of time, but I still want to ask a question. There, I remember when Hurricane Katrina, and you guys had a show before the hurricane hit, and you end up going to the show. We're going to skip certain parts of this, but we're going to, what was your effect on the people? Because remember in Louisiana, it was really bad. The people that did come out, what effect did you have on them?
Most people were happy when the show finished. They were crying. You know, full of joy, and said, Thank you very much. Thank you. Because people live nowhere. They're sleeping in
cars and
trees and all of that. Everywhere. Anywhere they can't find air to put on it. And that day when the band start, I have to cry. I burst out in tears and stayed. I said, wow. I can feel the people crying out, man. And when they finish, I have to hug some of them that's, and say, this is all I have to give.
Right.
And, you know, it was great.
It was really touching because we were, as you know, our life was far from perfect here because Katrina and Wilma affected us here before we flew up there. So our life was far from perfect. Everybody was trying. Some of us didn't have power at home and all of that. But when you think that your corner is dark,
right,
you take a look at somebody else's. When we went to Louisiana, like Baba said, when he came off stage and there were people running, of course he's the lead singer, so they're mostly running up to him to say, thank you, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The genuine look of gratitude,
right,
it forced you to think, like, okay, what was going through my head was, okay, so what are these people gonna do
after the
music, when the speakers go silent?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
Like, what do they have left?
Yeah. It was cause for pause.
Yeah, man.
Trust me. You know, they say it's always darkest before dawn.
Mm-hmm.
I always heard that term. It's darkest before dawn, and that was the time that I added this, my little twist to it. I said it's always darkest before dawn. But use your light wisely when it comes. Because, you know, we were coming from a not so good place, but when we saw that.
But it wasn't bad like that.
Better than those people over there, man.
Wow.
Because we didn't have a hotel.
For the first time.
We were not sleeping in a hotel when
we went somewhere, there was no hotel, and we had to understand.
Yep.
We weren't pleased at first, but when we really looked at
you too.
We weren't pleased at first, but honestly, people were sleeping in cars on the street. People were just walking the streets because they didn't have anywhere to sleep. So, you know,
we joined them. We have the energy to sleep.
Wow,
that's it.
Well. Thank you, gentlemen, so much for being here. This show could be all night long. I'm telling you, y'all don't know.
Yeah.
It could be all night long. But I want to say to the sponsors, thank you to all who supported and continue to support our sponsors, ConceitedClothing.com and LavishBayByTamara.com. When you support the sponsor, it allows them to support us. We are working with Zimroy Lewis and The Garden to become one of our sponsors. So please join Chris and I this Friday between 4 and 11 at The Garden, located at 4340 North State Road 7 in Lauderdale Lakes, for an outdoor seafood cookout. And come drink, eat, listen to good music. And I will also be at Henny Time in Hollandale this Saturday at a pop-up shop with one of our sponsors, ConceitedClothing.com, at 1 o'clock. So please go onto their website, support them. Please come out and to The Garden on Friday between 4 to 11 and meet these wonderful gentlemen. They're nothing but a band full of comedians. So just stop in, say hello, give some support, show your love. And before I go, in my burning spirit voice, I want to say it was good to be here. We thank you for your presence and we thank you for your support. We thank you for your oneness, togetherness. So hopefully some other future we can do this again together like we never do this again together before. So therefore, Jah guide and keep each and every one of you, each and every one of us, man, woman, and child, going out and coming in from all evil things and all evil doers. Accidents included. Please, people, be careful. Watch your back going out and watch your back going in. Peace. Have a good night, everybody. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for always supporting us. And thank you, gentlemen, for sharing your stories and music with us. We love you.
Yes. Let's not forget where we're from. For the show is the way you choose.
Chorus.
I'm gonna do it.
Official chorus.
And I hope no evil far from it. Let all the truth come from my lips. Bless our souls, so without you we can't make it.
Right to do.